Hello and welcome again. It's me again, Kenny Thompson, Project Management Consultant, and welcome to my YouTube channel, Learn with Kenny, hashtag. Today, I'm going to be talking about the Project Management Standards. But before I start, just in case you're hitting this particular series or this particular video for the first time, I advise you to look at my video number one, just to learn a little bit more about myself and just to simply tell you I'm no professional with photography. I'm just doing my best here to be able to record some of my studies online so that I can look at them at any point in time and hopefully help a few other people. I'm not going to dwell on that, but please check my first video just so you know a bit more about me. Like I said, today I'm going to be talking about the PMI Project Management Standards. In my previous video, I did mention that I did not use the word methodology simply because the Project Management Institute way of for you to become a PMP professional, the way of doing project management, there's not a methodology, they're just standards, and it's probably one of the first things they've stated in the PMBOK guide, that they are, you know, that the PMI's processes have been approved by the ANSI, ANSI organization as standards, which can be applied to any project. You can tailor it to any project, you can make sure it meets your organizational needs and all that. And for those of us, or for those of you who want to study the PMP exam, one of the first things that you might have hit is the fear of, my goodness, how am I going to put all of this together? All these inputs and processes and inputs, outputs, documents here and there. Well, I can tell you one thing for sure. Go to an organization and work as a project manager where they have absolutely no documentation and see whether you're going to be successful. That way you will understand that it's important to be as meticulous as you can be with your documentation. If everybody did their work with documentation, project management would be a lot easier today, to be quite honest. I'd rather good documentation than no documentation at all. In any organization I work, and it's very common, you know, you find a situation whereby there's so much stress to get it delivered on time, there's poor documentation here and there, and you don't really archive your records properly. But that's not what I'm here to talk about. I'm just trying to make you appreciate the need to understand why the Project Management Institute standards are so extensive and so deep. Just to maybe help you to appreciate what it is to be a quality and good project manager. Everything you read on the PMBOK guide, right? The whole of the standard is centered around a number of things. First of all, it's centered around five process groups. And within those process groups, you have 47 processes, right? Which all are important for you to think about and to look at when delivering a project. Now, all those five process groups or 47 processes are covered in what you call 10 knowledge areas. And I'm going to try and make that a bit easier, hopefully, or the way I see it, to make it easier for me to remember what the knowledge areas or what it is. Because when you try and take it as it is in the PMBOK guide, it can be quite daunting because your brain is like switching. Perhaps because you've done Agile, or you've done Prince 2, or you've done Waterfall. So all these different lexicons tend to like hit your brain left, right, and center, and you're not quite there to be able to know which one am I looking at. Am I doing Prince 2 now? Am I doing Agile? Am I doing Scrum? Am I doing Waterfall? Am I doing Kanban? And all that. And just take it easy, yeah? But we'll get there together. And in doing all those standards, you have outputs, inputs, tools, and techniques. And I'm going to try and talk about each one in detail now. The process groups, what I want you to do when you look at the process groups, because when you hear process groups and processes, it's very important for you to be able to differentiate. Yes, it's easy to differentiate, but believe me, when you're studying or when you're doing an exam under pressure, it's easy to miss out the sentence. They can ask you a question, in which process group does this happen? Or they say, in which process does this happen? And they'll put the answer where that process group and that process happen together. So you need to understand why. Because when I was studying, I'm like, well, why did they use the word process group? Why would they just use the word something else and then call the 47 processes sub-processes so that you can differentiate? But due to further studying, and I kind of look at it in a different way, look at the process groups. Is a group as a bucket, right? As a nice bucket, which is a group. And inside those buckets are the inside, are the processes. So for example, you have in project management, you have the initiating process group, right? So which is initiating. And in there you have various processes that you could do. For example, develop project charter or identify stakeholders. So you then have them. So then what you then do is, if you look at it as a bucket, the content processes, that way you can know that it's a group, but all the processes fall under that group. It makes it kind of easier for you to understand it as a container. Now, very quickly, we go back to the process groups. Now, I said five process groups. The process groups are initiating, planning, executing, monitor and control, and close projects. Now, it's very easy again to make a mistake and think that each of these is a phase. No, they are not phases. Please take that to heart. They are not phases. They are just pretty much process groups as they are to help you and guide you through stages that you are at any point in time in your project or that you may be trying to do. So what you want to do with this to prove that is this. When you talk about phases in a project, you could love, let's look at a software development lifecycle, for example, where the first phase is, for example, you want to gather requirements. You could call that gather requirements as a phase. Yeah? Now, when you want to gather requirements, you need to initialize it. You need to plan how you're going to gather the requirements. You need to execute the actual requirements gathering. You need to monitor and control what information you're gathering and what you're documenting. And once you finish that, you need to close it. So that's what phases actually mean. In what phase in the project are you actually doing? And in essence, in any phase of any project, you tend to go through all these process groups again. So I'm going to draw that very quickly again. I'm going to move to the other side so you can see is phase one in a project, phase two in a project, phase three in a project, for argument's sake. Let's change that again. We call gather requirements. Gather requirements. You call that you design, you call that you build, and so on and so forth. You build, you test, you implement, and all that. Here, you're going to have initiation, plan, execute, monitor and control, and then you close that phase. Same thing here as well. Detail. You initiate, you plan, you execute, you monitor and control, and you close, and everything. When you do, that is where phases come into play. So remember, initiation, planning, execution, monitor and control, and close are not phases according to the Project Management Institute standards. So you need to make sure that you have that at the back of your mind when you're studying through the rest of the PMBOK guide. Again, I'll say that again, the five process groups are not phases. Now, knowledge areas are interesting. Many of us are going to go ahead and try and study this in many different ways, which is interesting. Knowledge areas when I first looked at it, I thought, Christ, this is a lot. But to be honest, we do it every day. Now, we have obviously the integration management, you have the scope management, you have the time management, the cost management, the quality management, the human resource management, communication management, risk management, procurement management, and stakeholder management. I can't write them down because of the video, it's going to take me too long. You can check the Pinboard guide to write that. What I want to say about this is, they call them knowledge areas. I like to see them as chapters, right, in the overall book, which is what you call the project management plan. For those of you who do Prince 2, so that you might be a bit familiar, maybe you can call it the PID, the project initiation document. If I look at this, apart from integration management, for example, if I look at scope management, time management, cost management, quality, I could use them as chapters in my project management plan to say, okay, scope management, what are we doing about the scope of this project? What is in scope? What is out of scope? There's a process behind that, obviously, to collect the requirements and understand exactly what it is, and then you define the scope baseline. Or you want to talk about the cost, the overall budget is this, but the cost breakdown of what we're going to do is this. There's a process behind understanding the cost. So this is how I look at the knowledge areas, that they help me in actually developing the project management plan as far as the whole, what I'll call the Bible of the overall project is. That's how I look at it. And it's a lot easier when you think of it that way. Because when you think of it that way, then you know, hang on, I haven't even thought about cost. I haven't thought about risk. I haven't thought about human resources. I haven't talked about procurement. I haven't talked about quality. I haven't talked about time. And it's very important that you look at it that way. And that way it makes it easy for you to understand when you go into more detail and more detailed study about each knowledge area, how it all hangs together. And again, you have the outputs, the inputs, the tools and techniques. Now, in the PMI book, we talk about the inputs first of all, and we talk about outputs, and then we talk about the tools and techniques. I prefer to look at it that way. I'll tell you why. Because if you're a project manager, the first thing is you are kind of understand, what are you trying to achieve? You always begin with the end in mind, okay? What is the aim? Which essentially, what is the output? Then you think about, what do I need to get what I need? And then you now start thinking about, how do I get it? How was the technique? How do I go about doing it? Okay, let's take, for example, you want to develop a project charter, of course. The output is the project charter, correct? You now start thinking, to develop the project charter, what are the elements? What are the things I need to develop the project charter? How do I know exactly what works? Maybe I should go and find a business case and I will understand what the project, charter is all about, how I can develop that. Do we have any requirements from the sponsor? Obviously, or anything. That's how you think about the inputs. The inputs that they put in the PMI book does not mean you have to put every single or use every single input. It's just saying, these are the potential documents, or these are the potential sources of information in order to ultimately produce that output. Does that make sense now? Good. Now, tools and technique, they join it together because it's kind of difficult to separate them. Meeting is a technique. When you're using a particular product, it could be a tool itself. So, analytical techniques, reasoning techniques, expert judgment, or even a formal communication technique, or whatever it may be, comes under that. It's basically, how do you solicit or elicit the information that you need, right? When you get the input to be able to get the output. So, in summary, when you are studying the project management Institute standard you need to think that one, everything is surrounded around what? The five process groups, which are the five containers, right? In each of those containers, you have a number of processes. The total for all of them is 47 processes. And you have 10 knowledge areas, which in my way, I'll look at it as chapters that could form, you know, that could use to form my project management plan, which is kind of ultimately the document that you have in the project, in the overall project, but the project management. There's more documents, don't get me wrong, before you crucify me for that. But look at it as that, and I'll explain in my further studies. And then you think about, you begin with the end in mind, what am I actually trying to produce out of this process? What document am I trying, what's my output? Where do I source information from? What's my input? And also, and finally, how do I get those? But last but not the least is, I want you to be able to think of the process group and knowledge areas as what you actually do, okay? What you actually do. For example, to develop a project charter, it's an initiation process group. You actually do develop a project charter in there. To develop a project management plan, it's in the planning process group. To develop and manage a project is in the execution process group. The monitor and control and the perform integration control is performance integration control, and finally monitor and control process group. Obviously the close is a close. I need to note one thing though, you can close a project at any point in time for any reason. That could happen. Management could say they're not interested, or we're not going to get the value, or we'll spend too much money, or for whatever reason it can close. Maybe whoever you're dealing with goes out of business, just anything. A project can close at any point in time, and in closing a project at any point in time, it means you have to go through the whole processes of, you know, summing down that project and closing it properly, i.e. lessons learned, making sure the documents, making sure procurement documents are in place, making sure at least the reasons for the closure is also documented, any documents that you might have produced up to that are up to date. Those are things you need to make sure you need to do, and ensure that you do them properly. Believe me, a project without documentation, you don't want to be part of that, to be honest. It's always better than any project, no matter how little the documentation may be. Okay? Sorry, I take that back. Project without documentation is a nightmare. You would always, always be thankful to have some documentation. How much more a good one, you know, to when you don't have any and you're firefighting an office. No amount of integration or communication or stakeholder management skills you have will make that project an easy one for you. Thank you very much for this particular video, and I hope to meet you in my third video, which should come out anytime soon. Thank you.